I said, well, Lord, it's just like the apostles. Amen. They went to Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. I thank God that he brought me to a point that's at the uttermost part of the world. Amen. And then I can decree and declare that on this side, that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
We have a reason to lift up and glorify the name of Jesus. Listen, let me tell you something. If the Church of God in Christ can have Memphis, Tennessee, and the Apostolics, can have Indianapolis, Indiana, and if the Catholics can have Rome, hallelujah, and the Baptists can have the Bible Bowl, and the freaks can have New Orleans, and the homosexuals can have San Francisco, truly, I know we can have Columbus.
Amen. Amen.
We gonna lift up and let people know that Jesus Christ is real. It don't matter what they may think, what they may experience in their life, but we want them to know, just like y'all did, we was pulling up in a parking lot, that there's power in everything, and then most of all, there's power in the name of Jesus. How many of y'all know there's power in the name?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So truly, we thank the Lord. Thank God for Prophet Swinney, being in the house, the overseer being in the house, and to each and every brother Josh, Minister Josh, being in the house on today, and thank God for this young lady being in the house again. Amen. I thank God for seeing you again and let me know you had some victory this week, because I saw you today. Amen. So we thank God, and most of all, to the angel and shepherd of this house. Amen. We bless Pastor, and we lift him up and glorify him in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, right now, we're going to cut to the chase. Amen. We're going to get down in some word, the word of the Lord Jesus Christ. So once we get down, we're going to be able to raise up, because we know that there is power in God's word. Amen.
Amen.
Pastor said he's been teaching a series on obedience. Amen. And one thing I come to understand, that if we're going to walk in obedience, we got to realize there's things in our life that we need to nip in the bud. Amen. And that we need to make it right, and regardless of what goes on, amen, I thank God that we're able to do that. Like giving honor to my wife in the midst of her absence on today,
amen.
And we thank God for her, amen, and her strength in the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. I want to speak to you all. We're going to deal with obedience, but we're going to come to it in an aspect way of not looking at it as obedience, but because we consider it a lifestyle. And if I was going to use a topic on tonight, on this afternoon, so you see, I'm one of the preachers that's used to talking either early in the morning or late in the midnight hour. So if you may allow me to say this afternoon, amen, I want to use for a topic and bring to our understanding, recapturing holiness. Recapturing holiness. Why the word recapturing holiness? Recapture, anytime you deal with a word that has an R-E in it, it's bringing you back to a place where you used to be. And how do you know if you used to be in somewhere if you never fall out of somewhere?
Yeah.
Amen. So there was a song that the Whiners wrote back in the days when I was going, growing up in Detroit. It said, restoration has finally come. I've been restored back to my place in God. What would I know about being restored if I never lost my place? What would I know about his mercy if I hadn't gotten out of grace? So restoration has finally came, amen. And most of your churches today, I'm not afraid to say it, need to recapture holiness, amen. Because they really left the foundation of what God's word is to be implemented in our life, amen. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12 and 1, the scripture we're going to be reading from, let us read that. I beseech ye therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, two, holy, and three, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to start at the end and work my way back. It said, which is your reasonable service unto God. But what has come along and what has deterred us, or what has caused us to derail from what we are supposed to do when it comes to God?
Yeah.
We've been in church, most of us here have been in church all of our lives, amen. But somewhere along the way, we have lost our focus. We have lost our understanding, our determination to live for Christ or to die, amen. And a lot of times we have come to the place that we lost our reckoning of our lives to seeing and to knowing what God implements in our life, amen. We can go back to the beginning of the book of Acts, amen, hallelujah. And we understand that the books of Acts was the Acts of the Apostles, amen. And because it was the Acts of the Apostles, it speaks of where the beginning of the church is or was, hallelujah. So all the Acts that took place concerning the Apostles was through the giving and understanding of the beginning of the church. It dealt with fellowship. It dealt with prayer. It dealt with the breaking of the bread. It dealt with the baptism, amen. Hallelujah. It dealt with everything that began the beginning of the church in a place called Macedonia. And if you don't mind, I don't mind coming over here to this Macedonia and helping out. Amen, amen. So hallelujah, so here we are, we find ourselves that God is saying, what has happened to that which was acceptable unto God? Hallelujah, people are calling the bad things good and the good things bad, hallelujah. That's not acceptable unto God, hallelujah. Only thing that's going to be acceptable unto God, you must understand, is His Word. Why is it just His Word? Because you got to understand that the orchestrating of God's Word is what's going to produce obedience in your life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. The Bible says, hallelujah, that obedience is better than sacrifice. And we come to find out that most preachers today rather preach sacrifice than obedience. Because I found out more they preach sacrifice, the more money that the people are giving up. Hallelujah. They ain't doing enough for their heart. Ain't doing enough for their mind. Ain't doing enough for their hands. No deliverance. All they're doing is robbing folks.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, you know, most preaching today remind me back in the day when the women used to come to church, hallelujah, and they could away 120 pounds, 150 pounds, or 200 pounds, hallelujah. They wore these dresses called sack dresses or potato dresses, hallelujah. Hallelujah, the name was much preaching. It's just like these dresses, hallelujah. It would cover, hallelujah, your body up. You couldn't tell what size of the women was, but it's just like much preaching today. Cover everything, but don't talk about nothing. Don't talk about the blood. Don't talk about the power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Don't talk about what the name can do or anything for you. But we all caught up in what's going on now instead of what Jesus is doing. Hallelujah. So here we find that in Romans 12, 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Well, let's deal with one of the divine criteria that we'll be talking about, which is holiness. What is holiness? What does holiness is so significant about? Well, who is holiness? Holiness is a total devotion to God. Total devotion. And when I begin to understand what the total devotion was, y'all ready for this? This is where I figured out, according to the book of Matthew, how to live perfect or how to live holy, because he said, live holy for I am holy. Then he said, live perfect, for I am perfect. How many times
I done heard preachers saying that you can't get holy. We give the saints all the excuses in the world not to live right from up here. I done saw it, and it got to messing me up so much, Pastor, that I had to go home and get with this thing. God, you told me I can be perfect. Your word said it don't lie. So how am I to do it? I had to understand that through God's word and me presenting my body to a total devotion is what causes holiness to become my lifestyle. It's the way I live. It's the way I move. It's the way that in everything that I do, that I make him Lord supreme, that he is over my life. It's not my own intellect, but it's through the intellect of his rhema and his rough word.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus.
What is holy? God lets us know in 1 Samuel 2 and 2, God is holy.
Yes, yes, yes.
For there is none holy as the Lord. For there is none beside thee, neither is there any rock like our God. Now that's something. Because it's describing how he is, and get this, what he expects us to be. I can't live that. I got this going on with me, and I got this going on with me, and I got that going on with me. But then what you're really saying then is that you're not willing to submit to God's word. Because see, when you submit to the word of God, God's word will cause you to walk in obedience. Because when you got your mind made up and your heart set, there is nothing that you would do outside of that thing. Look at here. He, talking about God, is absolute perfection.
Oh, yes.
All
right. Come on.
My God.
This is good.
He is absolute perfection. So if God is absolute perfection, somebody should have shouted, because he expects for you to be absolute perfect.
Amen.
My God. And the reason why he can expect for you to be absolute perfected, because he said in the word, be holy. Do we come into perfecting ourselves in the holiness of God? He said, his holiness is the essence of that otherness. His holiness. Not the way I think holiness ought to be. It's not the way, I know you're the pastor and everything, but it's not even the way you think it ought to be.
Wow.
It's that only thing that's the otherness that only matters. And the otherness is the word of God. It is the perfection of the intent of God's word in our lives. I can't do it unless God do it. You play that song at the cross. That's my song. That's my remedy. Because it was at the cross, where I first saw the Lord. It was at the cross. When I look at Calvary, or when I think about Calvary, I think about the perfection of what it did. I think about the results of what it brought. Jesus did not die on Calvary for me to be a loser, but to be a conqueror in him who loved us. Mm-hmm.
preach it.
I'm more than a conqueror. I said, well, Lord, what's a conqueror? What makes me more? What is it that makes me more than a conqueror? And I remember God brought the illustration to me. And when he went down into hell and preached the word and then kicked the devil's door wide open, kicked him to the side and took the keys of death away from him, it made him conqueror over death. And he let me know I'm more than a conqueror because I used to drink, but I don't drink no more because once I conquered it, I ruled over it. I became a ruler, hallelujah, over every weakness that man took my life and placed it in the hand of disobedience. But now that my life is in the hand of an obedient God, I can present my body a living sacrifice and make it holy and make it acceptable under God.
Ooh, I got a bocia. Ooh, I got a bocia.
Under God.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Thank you,
His
Jesus.
His very being is completely absent. Check out holiness. His very being, my God, is completely absent from a trace of sin.
Yes.
Complete. There's not a trace in of sin that ever rose up in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Never had, never will. Only time that sin was sought or saw on him is when God turned his back on him at Calvary, because of why he was there for to represent.
Yes.
But just because he represented, hallelujah, the death over sin, even over that, sin still could not have it.
Ooh, get up a shadow, see ya. Ooh, hallelujah.
God turned his back on the cause of sin.
Yeah.
And not on Jesus. Because he was able to present his only begotten son.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Because he was without flaw. And don't you know, because you're in Jesus, that you're flawless now? Somebody asked a question one day and said, what's the difference between everlasting and eternity? Oh, I said, that's easy. I got that. Eternity always was, always is, and always will be.
Yes.
Everlasting starts right now when you accept Jesus Christ, and then there's no ending because of what the blood has done.
My God. Mm.
Holiness, God, he is high above any other,
yes,
and no one can compare to him. That's why it's so important that we walk in integrity.
Right.
Because if we don't walk in integrity, how somebody that ain't going to save going to know the difference between somebody who is saved and ain't saved?
Yes.
You got to separate yourself. That's why God told us that we got to live in holiness. What does it mean for us to live holy? God told Israel to be holy in Leviticus chapter 11 and verse 19. Israel, that's what it's come for. Pastor. He must get this. Listen, if somebody in the church, and I'm saying it like this because evidently they don't know nothing, supposed to be in the church, tells you to live outside of what God's word is saying, they ain't saved. So don't follow that instruction. Somebody say instruction.
Instruction.
Here it is. Leviticus 11:19, God told Israel to be holy. Listen why he tells them to be holy. He was instructing them to be distinctive from other nations by giving them specific regulations to govern their lives. If you go and work at Burger King, you can't represent McDonald's. You can't go in the Burger King with a McDonald's outfit or uniform. I can't go into a Burger King and ask for a 2-off beef patty, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, or a sesame seed bun. I can't expect to get a Big Mac from a place that serves the Whopper. Mm-hmm. And many of us have been so destituted in the church to where we can think we can come to God and ask God for anything.
Yeah.
But God don't even operate like that. These instructions that are given by God will let the world know that they were God's special people.
Yes. Amen.
Anybody that is filled with the Holy Ghost are God's special people. What
yes.
makes them special?
Come on.
Yes.
What makes you, what makes somebody out in the world look at you and say, and see themselves more, see you more special than them? What causes them to even want to think like that? Because when they see the work of God in your life, it must be something. What can come up in there, and it's just something about you.
Amen. Amen.
That's what the world says. The world says, it's something about you, man.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And if you don't, and what happens, they should be turned around and acting like Nicodemus. Nicodemus said to Jesus, what must I do to be saved?
Yes.
He said, Nicodemus said, man, you're the rabbi. You're the rabbi. I can tell by just the way you're talking. Hallelujah. People ought to know that you were sent by the rabbi just by the way you talk. Hallelujah. Just by the way you move. Just by the way you school. Just by being no fool. But you end up with Jesus Christ and then find out you got life. And they want that life that you died so they can live in the bosom of Jesus Christ. Because he's the one that died that you may live and live and live.
Amen. Amen. Woo, how you that will shine that.
See,
thank you, Jesus.
This is the main part right here. You know why so many big churches are so big? Because they ain't set apart. They are not set apart.
Come on, preacher.
I heard a preacher sing one time to his elders in front of the saints, if I can't get no extra, you can't either. If the church folks is doing what the worldly folks are doing, and the worldly folks, hear me, y'all ready for this? And the worldly folks are doing what the church folks is doing. In the New Testament, we are reading the Greek word cosmos. Cosmos most often refers to the inhabited earth and the people who live on the earth, which functions apart from God. Satan is the ruler of this cosmos. In John 12:31, by the simple definition that the world world refers to a world system ruled by Satan. We can more readily appreciate Christ's claim that the believers are no longer of this world.
Mm-hmm.
We are no longer ruled by sin, nor are we bound by the principles of this world. In addition, we are being changed into the image of Christ, causing our own interest in the things of the world to become less and less as we mature in Christ. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, time to grow.
So we can go. Yes.
We are destined. Y'all ready for this? I don't know if you know. But we are, Jesus Christ did so much for us. We are destined to leave the world behind.
Amen.
And that's what obedience will cause you to leave friends behind, people they ain't right behind, jobs, the things of the world behind. Why? Because we're walking in holiness, because we're at a point now that we're presenting our bodies. Too many times we want to present something, but we don't want to present the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
And God intends through his word that we prevail and travail. We must first make sure we are born again believers. If we truly are believers, then we can recognize that our position in Christ automatically sets us apart from the world.
Mm-hmm.
After all, we have a relationship with the living God. Then we must daily live a set apart life, not trying to blend in.
See,
church blend in with the world, we'd be using the same excuses that the world uses. The same excuses. Instead of saying, God gave me victory, oh God, I know I messed up.
Mm-hmm.
I know I messed up.
Mm-hmm.
You hear what I'm saying? I know I messed up. But that's all I'm saying. I know I messed up. It's good to know he'd be there if ever I fall.
Mm-hmm.
But it's better to know I don't have to fall at all.
Yes.
That's right.
And we don't have to fall.
No.
Mm-hmm.
The word of God said, greater is he that is in us.
Yes.
Than he that is in the world.
Yes.
What Jesus had done for us on Calvary, what he did for us while he was walking, what he did for us when he was preaching, hallelujah, the blessed Sermon on the Mount, what he did for us, hallelujah, when he went into the garden and prayed for at least 1 hour, what he did for us, hallelujah, when he told Peter, get thee behind me, hallelujah, what he did for us, when he said, Peter, upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell cannot prevail, what he did for us, what he did for us, somebody ought to be glad to say it, what he did for us.
After.
Do you know teaching is